Welcome to the show, Matt Miller with you. It may only be day two of 2019, but science never sleeps. And I've called up a lovely man that never sleeps also, Dr. Brad Tucker from Canberra. Thanks so much for your time, man.
No worries. Yeah, science never sleeps, neither do I, especially when there's flying spacecraft and above you.
It's incredible. There are a couple of exciting things happening in the solar system right now, aren't there?
That's right. You know, and what just happened is about, 14 hours ago or so local time, New Horizons, you know, people might remember that name for when this is the probe that passed Pluto in July 2015, where everyone fell in love with, just passed its next object, what we call Ultima Thule, and the first images just arrived here on Earth less than an hour ago.
And they are available, and I've got it here on screen now for those watching on YouTube. It's a peanut.
It is. It is a space peanut. And look, it might, this blurry image might not look like a lot, but this, it's 6.5 billion kilometers away. It took over 8 hours to get here to Earth. It's actually traveling, you know, the data download is slower than a dial-up modem. It's one of those things where it's quite impressive that you actually got this. And the higher res images will trickle out over the next days to weeks to months.
It is an absolutely incredible image. And the scale of it is just so hard to comprehend that it took another 3 years from Pluto to get here.
That's right. You know, New Horizons left Earth in 2005, arrived in Pluto at 2015, in July 2015, and just now today arrived at its next object. And that's just the next thing it did. You know, when we talk about space being big, I don't think people appreciate space is big, and there's sometimes not ways around it. You know, this thing is traveling 50,000 kilometers an hour, and it took 3.5 years to get there from Pluto.
Now, it was a stretch goal for NASA, wasn't it? Because New Horizons was intended to go to Pluto. Then they found Ultima Thule, and they went, well, why don't we just go there?
Yeah, so it was the goal of this mission, as you said, was to fly by Pluto. And those, you know, the images and data are fantastic from Pluto, and people are still analyzing it. And it was always hoped that when it was built, there'd be enough fuel and energy that they could do one maneuver to go past another of these objects. So all of these objects are what we call the Kuiper Belt. This is the body of solar system. You know, we have the asteroid belt in between Mars and Jupiter. This is a different belt of objects on the outside of our solar system. And it was always hoped that we'd be able to pass by one. And what happened was in 2013 and 2014, it hadn't been discovered yet. An object hadn't been discovered yet. So there was a team that used the Hubble Space Telescope to look at a ton of data and a ton of area to see, can we find another object? And they found this one, what's called 2014 MU69. But because that's a terrible name, Ultima Thule is the nickname of preference.
I love it. And is there enough? I think I was reading on BBC that there might be enough fuel to go somewhere else, one more place, or is that?
There is. So there's enough battery and energy to go for another 20 years. And this maneuver required so little turning that they now are confident if they find the right target, they can go buy a third object. And this is quite important. It's been well established that the Kuiper Belt has two distinct regions, the inner region where Pluto is. And with these, it's actually been theorized that they actually could have been just part of the normal solar system and got flung out by Uranus and Neptune. Then there's the second part of the Kuiper Belt object, which is where Ultima Thule is, which is formed there and stayed there. So essentially, it's been there since the beginning of our solar system 4.6 billion years ago. So finding another one of these where we've only seen now one, you know, literally one, a peanut one, is the interesting part. So they'd like to do another maneuver.
The best thing for me as an Australian that learned was that Tidbinbilla is going to be one of those key tracking stations downloading the data when it starts coming in next week, I believe it is.
That's right, exactly. So they were part of the communication and the triangulation, essentially, for the flyby. They will get the first high res image downloaded to Earth later this week. And that's kind of always one of the cool things is Australia always has this role, no matter where we look, in these really cool space missions.
It was a bit disappointing to learn that Madrid got the first transmission this morning.
Yeah, that's right, exactly. But you know,
you're gonna share it around.
That's right, and then I think Tidbinbilla, Australia, got the first Pluto image. So It all works out.
Now, how does that work? I should hit up Glenn again from Tidbinbilla, but how does it work when Canberra downloads the high-res image? Do they Dropbox it to NASA? How does that work?
there is essentially a computerized network, so they're all on the same NASA network. So they'll download the image, and then they'll direct it to the mission control operations of that mission, which this one happens to be at Johns Hopkins University, which is in Baltimore. It's actually the same campus where the Space Telescope Science Institute is, which houses and controls the Hubble Space Telescope. So it's all kind of in the same area.
So they're not on the NBN then?
No, it's faster.
Probably a good thing.
I don't know. It's a good race between the NBN and the data download from 6.5 billion years ago. Same resolution.
Oh, love it. Hey, look, a lot closer to home, there is a probe about to land on the far side of the moon.
Yes, Chang'e 4. And this is kind of a really cool mission that I think is slightly flown under the radar. In fact, it was supposed to land yesterday. They've delayed it a day or two. And so this is a Chinese-led mission that's going to land a rover on the far side of the moon essentially any time in the next day or two.
What's so special about the far side of the moon?
So it's interesting. So firstly, the far side of the moon isn't the dark side of the moon as much as, you know, Pink Floyd said it was. As an aside, I would go, Brian May, the guitarist for Queen, wrote a special song for New Horizons Flyby. So go on YouTube and search for that. And so the far side of the moon is the side that just doesn't face the Earth. We always see one side that faces the Earth. And so sometimes we see it as a new moon, but the far side has a different composition than the near side. So firstly, when you look at the moon and you see those dark gray areas, those are what we call the most recent volcanic lava flows. Those don't really exist on the far side of the moon. And so we know there's differences in the amount of ice, there's differences in the amount of what we call helium-3. So there's a bunch of different compositions, both scientifically interesting and interesting for potential harvesting of resources for future exploration of the moon.
Do you think that it could possibly be that the far side of the moon is more viable for colonization, or do you think it'll always be the near side?
I think people, this question is really, could we do both? So one of the other aspects of it is the far side of the moon, because it never faces the near, you know, us, is that it's one of the most radio quiet places in the universe. So all of the radio transmissions from the Earth are essentially blocked. So for radio communications, it's actually, people have wanted to put a radio telescope on the far side of the moon for 50 years, essentially. And I think the whole ultimate question is there enough difference in composition that it warrants looking at both sides of the moon? Technologically, it's always been challenging because you're blocked by the moon. You can't communicate to the Earth. So China had to build two relay probes so it goes back to Earth. And that's always been one of the technical tricks of landing on the far side of the moon, which they've solved.
If Australians get there first and we build the first radio telescope on the far side of the planet, do you think we're going to have to send some sheep up and put it put a sheep station right there in the middle?
Yeah, and then we'll have to have Sam Neill still around to make a movie about it.
That's the Australian tradition, isn't it? Middle of a sheep paddock.
Exactly. You know, we need some space kangaroos hopping by this radio telescope. And look, and there's a lot of cool things. There's an experiment done by a bunch of Chinese universities that have built this little bubble that has a different types of seeds to see, can they grow stuff in a controlled environment on the far side of the moon, which has different properties than the near side. So there's lots of things that it will tell us. And next year, China has a very ambitious plan. They want to land another rover that takes samples that eventually comes back to Earth. So, you know, there's a lot of push to going back to the moon, both by China, the US, Russia, private companies. And that's what we'll see over the next 5 years, is the moon is the place to be.
So 2019 marks the 50th anniversary of Apollo 11. Do you think that the space race is almost back on to get to the moon?
I would say the space race is even bigger than before. And it's not just because it's one or two countries. You have multiple countries working together. You have multiple private companies. And now there's actually a reason. People always ask why we didn't go back to the moon. And that's because we never had a reason to. We kind of, the goal was to get to the moon, and we got there. And so it's kind of like, what now? And then everyone said, well, let's do things in space. So everyone built space stations. People forget that there was Mir and Skylab and the International Space Station. That's where everything happened. So there was no reason to go to the moon, which was a lot more difficult and costly. Now there are scientific and technological goals So that's what we'll see. And, you know, there's, I think over the next 3 to 4 years, we will start seeing space stations and bases and people around the moon. It will be an exciting time, as you said, just almost to the day, 50 years after all the Apollo missions.
Absolutely incredible, Brad. Will you come back when there's more science news and tell all of us Trekzone people about it?
Of course. Thanks.
Love it, mate. Thank you so much for your time.
Anytime. Take care.